And see, welcome to my YouTube channel. So today I want to talk about something I'm super passionate about, which is worship. And worship in the context with which I'll speak of it today is in the context of music. If you know anything about me, you'll know that I absolutely love music. And yeah, you know, God has graced me and I've had the opportunity of leading worship on various platforms. And it's an honor really to be able to do that. But I think one of the greatest challenges that I have faced in my journey is how do I cultivate an atmosphere of the presence of God. And a song that I really, really love, called Nothing Else by Cody Kant, you probably know it, always ministers to me. You know, it talks about nothing else will do, I just want you. It's talking about how, it's talking about a hungry heart, a heart that is hungry for God. And that is the posture that I believe most, if not all, worshippers desire to cultivate or to have when they're leading worship, or even if they're part of the congregation and just receiving from whatever the leaders are releasing. But they always, a true worshipper's heart is always that of desiring and wanting to cultivate the presence of God. And so that song, Nothing Else, I recently was in a place in my life where I felt like I couldn't sing those song, that song genuinely, because I felt like it wasn't authentic. I felt like there was so much that was, you know, fighting for my affections, fighting for my attention, such that Jesus wasn't at the center. Jesus wasn't all I was focusing on. And I remember one day in just, I was anxious and I was just restless and I just went to pray and I just told Jesus in all honesty, Jesus, honestly, I can't sing this song genuinely, you know? I can't say right now that nothing else will do, I just want you. It should be my heart's cry, but right now, that's not how I feel. And I remember his words to me in that moment were, it's okay because I just want you. And I'm like, what? He said, and then, you know, he said it again, I just want you. And I'm like, I've never seen that song from that perspective. I'd always seen it as a heart that is desiring God. But I've never thought of it as God desiring man, God desiring me, so much where he would say that nothing else will do, I just want you. And that is actually the true heart of intimacy. And sometimes we are so caught up in wanting to do things for God, you know, to please God, to worship God, to do the right thing. But we forget that we are at the center of his attention, we are at the center of his affection, such that all he wants is us. You know, whether we are paying attention or not, his eyes are constantly on us. And that he would sing that over me, that he says, nothing else will do. I just want you, Essie. I just want you. Whoever you are, Jesus just wants you. I want you to imagine just how insane that is. And that lifts off such a burden from your shoulders, from your back, because, you know, you don't have to try and woo God, so to speak. You know, sometimes we think that maybe after 3 or 4 songs that the presence falls, you know, you have to sort of woo God so that his presence will be made manifest. But that's not true. He is eager, he is longing for us, such that the moment I just turn my eye on him, that I turn my affection towards him, his is already towards me. And he's so excited, he's so delighted. A good illustration is, if you know the story of the prodigal son, it's in Luke chapter 15. I encourage you to go and check it out, to read it. It talks about a son who had left home. And you know, when life got difficult, he decided to come back home. And the Bible says, when he was still a long way off, the father saw him and ran towards him. He probably saw the son before the son saw him. And that is not even the point. The point that, you know, this son was walking towards home. As soon as he was in the horizon, as soon as he was within the father's, you know, eyesight, meaning his father was constantly just looking out for him. He was looking out for the day, when will my son ever come back? And it's the same with worship. when will, you know, my son, when will my daughter ever just come and spend 5 or so minutes with me? And when we do that, he is so excited. And we don't have to coax him to do anything. He is delighted, you know, to manifest himself, to reveal himself, to move in the lives of those who love him. So this is just an encouragement to you if you're a worship leader or if you're just, you know, somebody who loves worship. And I mean this in the aspect of music. Don't worry, you know, about trying to cultivate the atmosphere. Just be concerned with looking at him. And just always know that his eyes are towards you. So when you lift up your eyes towards him, your eyes will meet his gaze. And it says it's beautiful, it's intimate, it's even, that's why I think there's even people who go to an extent of romanticizing the love of God. I personally do that. I know there's debates about that, but there is something so intimate in how God relates with man. And I think it's an aspect that has been overlooked by many. But once we see that his affection is towards us and we lean towards his affection rather than relying on our affections towards him, I think it makes the whole aspect and dynamic of worship so much easier. So I hope this encourages you. I hope this helps you out even as you lead worship or as you worship in your Sunday services or just at home. It doesn't matter. You can experience the fullness of the love of God and experience full intimacy with Jesus wherever you are, because his mind is fixed on you. His heart is fixed on you. Amen. I hope this blesses you. That's all for today. Bye.